What's good? It's your boy 2K here. Shout out to the movement and everybody who's moving with us. And speaking to about the movement anyway, I got three cats from the movement on this panel. I got my man Bo from Truth and Facts About Boxing. How you doing, family?
What's good, man?
All right. And then I got my man Willie the Kid. That's going to be, wait a minute, hold on. I introduced y'all wrong, bro. Bo, left hand man. Willie the Kid, right hand man. How you doing, fam?
Of course, that motherfucker on the left hand.
I'm good. I'm gonna interchange y'all motherfuckers, man. One day.
Nah, man, fuck that, man. Well, you ain't never gonna have to walk me across the street, but with Bo, you never know.
So. Hell yeah. Well, I got to put him on my right side. My right hand is the strong hand, dog.
Yeah, you gonna have to hold him tight, man.
Word up.
Yeah. And then I got you gotta let your children have a little fun. You gotta let your children have fun.
Here we go. Then I got my man C-Bone, aka Boxing's Boomhauer, man, from Four Corners Boxing Talk. How you doing, fam?
How y'all guys doing today, man? I'm doing fucking awesome.
Really? So how was that dude?
I'm doing super motherfucking fly. How about that?
Super fly. Hey yo.
Yeah.
I'm surprised Bo's still up for this show.
Hey, you know I actually went to the motherfucking movie theater to see that motherfucking movie, right?
Oh, you did?
Goddamn right I did, nigga. Got my ass beat all kind of ways, too.
What was you, like 45 when that came out?
Hey, man, start the show, man. What are we about to talk about?
Start the show, man.
Start the show, man.
Y'all motherfuckers are stupid, man. All right, of course, for this, if you haven't already seen the title, you already know what it is. Then this is going to be the Super Flyweight 2 breakdown that's happening this weekend, 9:30 Eastern time on HBO Boxing After Dark. I also put in the title and flyweight card simply because we got two flyweight fights as well, and that's where we're going to start. So to cap this off, or to start it off anyway, we're going to have Brian Viloria versus Artem Dalakian for the vacant WBA 112 pounds title. Now, of course, Brian Viloria, man, he's been around the block. He's 37 years old. He's a four-time champion, WBC and IBF at 108 and WBO and WBA at 112, right? He's fought everybody. You know what I'm saying? The experience is a factor. He's fought Juan Francisco Estrada. He's fought Roman Gonzalez. He's fought Hernan Marquez. He's fought Ulysses Solis, etc. He's been around the block. And then, of course, you got Artem Dalakian. He hasn't had a title shot. This is going to be his first shot at the title. He's from the Ukraine. He's primarily fought in the Ukraine. This is going to be his first fight in the U.S. He's 15-0 with 11 knockouts, man. Got power in both hands. I'm going to go to my man, Bo, because I like to respect my motherfucking elders. What do you think about this fight, man? Break it down. Give me a prediction.
Man, who was you talking about again?
Man, serious, bro.
Man, here's what I'm talking about, man. I gotta weed out the casuals, dog. Willie, fire this nigga, please.
if we fire him, then he gonna collect Social Security.
Yeah, that's right.
Motherfucker, you late. I'm already doing that. But who are you talking about for real, man? I lost
Brian
my train. Gloria
versus Artem Dalakian for the vacant flyweight.
WBA.
You know what? I'm gonna be honest with y'all. I want to go with the other guy, Arlington 10, but I don't know, man. I think Viloria gonna shock us in this fight, man. I think he's gonna come with a better game plan. I think he's, you know, I don't know, man. It's just something about this fight that's just telling me to go with Viloria. And it's not something I can say to sit here and say, hey, this makes sense, because it really doesn't. Because when you look at it, he doesn't necessarily look like he can beat Arlington 10, but it's just something about it. I just feel like this guy's due, man. So I'm gonna go with Viloria, and I'm gonna have to come back and eat crow when it happens, man.
All right. Well, I think Dalakian's a fresher fighter. He's younger. He hasn't had any wars. And when you're 37 years old and you have fought everybody, you've been around the block. That can help you, but that can also hurt you.
Exactly.
So, that's something to pay mind to. I would say I like the kid in this one. I think the youth is gonna play a part, and I think the power that he has in both hands, because he can hit you with the left and the right. Now it's a big step up in competition. So my question will be: will the bright lights get to him?
It's a good point. See,
what you want to know? I think Blackian is your straight, is your normal, straight up and down Eastern European fighter.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he is.
Okay.
Perfectly put.
And Beloya isn't something that's fancy or nothing like that by no means, as far as he's got a hell of a jump rope. He's mm-hmm. the best I've ever seen on a jump rope. Okay, but that's beside the point.
Scott Knight might think differently, but go ahead.
Yeah, Scott's pretty damn good on it. Beloya is fire, boy. I ain't kidding you. I do believe that all your physical advantages go to the younger guy, but we're not talking about a guy that's exactly like 24, 25 here. I think Blackian's 30 or 31, somewhere in that area now.
Yeah.
Already. Yeah. There's not a big size difference here. They're pretty close in size, actually. I'm with Bo in the fact that I think Beloya turns back the clock here. I think there's a huge experience difference. You've been in with Gonzalez and Estrada and guys like this. And I mean, he barely lost to Estrada. Barely. Okay.
Yeah.
So I believe that it's a little too quick for Blackian, to be honest with you. Just maybe a little bit more than what he's ready for right now.
Yeah. I mean, you're absolutely right. He is the epitome of an Eastern European fighter. You know what I'm saying? Straight up and down, a bit robotic. Really no footwork, kind of just plods and shit. Yeah. But the thing is this, man. I'm looking at Brian Valoria's last fight against Miguel Cartagena. And Brian Valoria, you know, though he's still, in my opinion, a high-class fighter, he has lost a step. You know what I'm saying? 37 years old will do that to you. And one of the steps that he has lost that he had actually depended on throughout his career was his reaction time. I see Miguel Cartagena landing shots that guys at his particular skill level should not have been landing on a guy like Brian Valoria. You know what I'm saying? And the kid, Dalakian, he actually waits for his opportunities. I mean, he can get a bit wild at time, but when he's actually reading his opponent, he does a pretty decent job of having a good punch variation, especially when he's on the inside. Now, that's another thing that Brian Valoria does now in his older age. He's not moving as much. C talked about how he's got good jump rope and ability, but you don't see that footwork in the ring anymore.
You don't.
You know what I'm saying? So
that's why I said he's not exactly a slick fighter or nothing like that by no means anymore.
Exactly. More so kind of like what my man C says about himself now that he's an older man. He sits in the pocket. You know what I'm saying? And you see more of that from Brian Valoria today, kind of just mid-range distance, throwing combinations. He also has great punch variation as well to the head, to the body. But he's not really doing a lot of movement. He's not really using the ring anymore. He didn't really do that when he was younger, but he did more of it when he was younger than he does now. And I think that's going to be a problem because he will definitely be in range of Dalakian. The kid is pretty tough. I think he's a strong fighter at 112. He previously fought at 118. He imposes his will on his opponents, man. And he breaks them the fuck down, especially to the body. If you look at him, he's got an excellent lead hook to the body that breaks a lot of his opponents down. You know what I mean? Now, that's not really saying too much because the majority of his opponents were relegated to the Ukraine and they were, you know, pretty much bum-licious. You know what I'm saying? But bum-licious. Yeah, that's a new word, y'all. Y'all better give me my fucking credit. But a 37-year-old guy like Valoria, man, I just believe that he's going to give Dalakian, the younger fighter, more opportunities than he should. I think this is going to be a close fight. I think Brian Valoria will come out of the gates winning the fight. And if Dalakian can actually last, which I think he will, because I don't think Valoria will be able to hurt him, I think eventually he will get broken down. I think this could be one of those split decision type of wins. But I'm going to go with the young kid, Artem Dalakian, for that. He should win his first title in his career.
I like how I stay neutral.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
No, I was just about to say that. See, the thing with that is, though, like I actually look at Brian Valora like a low weight version of Orlando Salido, a cat that's been around a long time that can still
he's be more skilled than Salido is.
He's more
Cat that can be around for quite a long time. Now, going back to that Miguel Cartagena fight, 2K is right about one thing. Cartagena was able to catch him with some hooks, and Cartagena was able to bait him into getting into more of a slugfest than probably Valora should have gotten into. But I don't know, man. I just think he's due with this fight with that guy Dalakatan, man.
I don't think that was as much baiting as it was just Valora feeling like he could do that.
Man. Yeah. I think in that Miguel fight, I think he thought he could run through Miguel.
I think it's a combination of both, where he knows that he could have gotten hit with those shots and take them, and at the same time he can't dodge those shots like he used to.
That's a good point, Will.
You know, he's not as, like, to 2K's point, he's not as slick as he once was.
Yeah, that's right. Because his head movement has slowed down drastically also.
And that was a big part of his game. So that's what scares me about this fight. Because this kid got punchy power in both hands. Like, I know he's face bums, but he could hit you hard. He hits hard.
Yeah, he does, man. He's literally crippling motherfuckers in the ring. You know what I'm saying? And I think Brian Valora, he's never been knocked out.
Valoria, yeah,
he has been knocked out.
Who are you knocked out by? Gonzalez,
yeah.
Oh, yeah. You're right. Roman Gonzalez got him, and that was the high pressure. But the problem is with Dalakian, he doesn't apply high pressure until he sees his opponent hurt. That's when he's all over that motherfucker. He's an excellent finisher, man. So I don't know, man. This is gonna be a tough fight. I think it's gonna be a split decision type of win.
Yeah, I'm figuring it to be a close fight myself. I just figured that Valora gets a decision in L.A.
That's a good point.
That's a good point, yeah.
Yeah, that's a really good point.
All right, let's move to the next one. The other flyweight fight on this Super Flyweight 2 card. We got my motherfucking dude. Now, this is my dude right here, man. I've been talking about this cat for a long time. My man, Donny Nietes. He'll be facing the rugged veteran, and Juan Carlos Revico. Shit, Donny Nietes is a veteran as well. But the thing with Nietes is, man, in my opinion, he hasn't really gotten the fights to basically showcase himself, showcase the skills that he probably should be getting credit for throughout his career. And if you actually look at this card, man, y'all might disagree with me, but if you look at everybody's resume and you compare and contrast, I think Donny Nietes probably has the weakest resume out of every fighter on this card. You know what I'm saying? Maybe besides Sore Rungvisai.
Pretty sure.
Yeah.
Are you talking about the champions, the A side, the red corner? Okay.
Right.
Yeah. Well.
Yeah, because Valoria has a better resume. I think Carlos Quadras has one. I can go to the B side. Revco has a better resume. You know, Estrada has a better resume. So
come out than Nietes, right?
Than Nietes, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. His signature win, in my opinion, is best one, even though it's an older one, may even be Sosa, man. I'd have to think about it.
Yeah, it is. I agree.
even though it's an older Sosa, but he shut him out pretty handily, I think, if I remember correctly.
I mean,
the Fuentes fight, you know, we've seen what Higa just done to him, and he had a draw with him, but that was quite a while ago, what, 5-6 years ago, something like that?
Yeah, exactly. But it's just, you know, I think he's 40-1. The last fight he's lost was, what, 14 years ago? It was in 2004, I believe. So,
quite some time.
Yeah, it was quite some time ago, and I believe it was by, like, majority decision or some shit like that. I'm not looking at his box record or anything, but, I mean, the dude has been beating cats for a very long time, but he hasn't gotten the spotlight because the majority of his wins come against competition that, you know, that's a lot of people don't really see those guys as giving him being a threat towards him. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. But this particular fight, Donny Nietes is the IBF champion belt that he pulled off of a top fighter. I can't pronounce his name, but I know who he is. received in April of last year. This will be his first title defense. Nietes is a 35-year-old former 3-time champion, WBO at 105 and 108. And of course, currently he's the IBF champion. And then you got, of course, Juan Carlos Revco, man. He's a 34-year-old former 3-time champion as well. And he's held the WBA title at 108 and twice at 112. Let's go to my man Willie the Kid for this one, man. How you see this fight? Break it down. Tell me your prediction.
Shit, man. I kind of like Nietzsche in this fight.
Yeah.
I just feel like his skill set in this fight will play out. And I think even though you guys were just discussing resume, I think he's going to show folks something, because I think he's one of those underneath-the-radar type guys that never really gets talked about and doesn't really get the fights that he should get. So right. Even though it's a step up, I like his chances in this one, man. I just feel like he's a more skilled fighter, period.
I think this is actually, well, besides Estrada Sorungvisa, I think this fight right here could be the more technical fight, in my opinion, on the card. Because you got two guys that are, they're veterans, they're pretty smart fighters, and they don't go in there doing any stupid shit. It's going to be a pretty good fight across the board. Steve, what do you think about this fight, fam?
I believe both of these guys are up in age. Both of them's in their mid-30s, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes, they are.
34 and 35.
Nietes, we don't really know how good he is. I mean, that's because of the resume you touched on. Yeah. But I do feel from the eye test, okay, and that's really all I got to go off. I mean, he has the Sosa wins by far the best, like you said. At least it is in my opinion. And the loss come what is like his first dozen fights, if I'm not mistaken. And you got to understand it happened over in the Philippines or some shit, or someplace like that. He had a draw and a loss and everything was real close. But you got to understand how they score over there. It's a bit different than us. Although it is a 10-point month system. It's just if a round's close, fuck it, that's 10-10. You know what I mean?
Right.
Whereas even though a fighter may have done something that he deserves to win that round, he may not have got it, you know. And when he actually lost, that's he was kind of dealing with a situation. Actually, he wasn't even in the Philippines. I think he went to a foreign country to fight a guy. But either way, I just think with the eye test, and Rebeco is a lot better fighter than people give him credit for.
Oh, yeah. Right?
Interestingly enough, both of these guys, their last opponent was the same exact guy.
Yes, sir.
And then Nantepec or whatever. How the fuck you say that Thai guy's
name? Nantepec. That's what I'm saying. Yeah. I can't pronounce his name.
Interestingly enough, both of them got fight was that guy. And they both beat him about the same.
Yeah.
So, you know, but it's actually, I think Rebeco actually probably was a little bit wider, at least in my opinion. Mm-hmm. But either way, neither here nor there. I believe that in this situation, man, I'm gonna call for Nietes to beat him, but I think it's gonna be like a 115-113 type score, maybe.
Interesting. Okay.
I can see that.
Yeah, I'm going with Donnie Nietes, and here's the thing, and he mentioned the guy that they had in common was Nantepec, whatever you pronounce their name. Both of them, here's the thing. I just thought that Nantepec was able to be a little bit more effective against Rebeco than he was against Nietes. Now, Nietes, the thing that Nietes does very good that I think could be effective against Rebeco is he does work behind the jab. Now, he's going to have to work on his balance because sometimes he throws, when he throws his right hand, he steps forward just a little bit too much. So when he steps through it, he actually steps back and he steps back with his head up. You're going to have to watch that because Rebeco is a hell of a counterpuncher.
Yes, he is.
So he's going to have to watch that. And now his defense is a little bit like Nietes, I think, has a little bit more better defense. He bends at the knees. He bobs and weaves a little bit more. But again, that's where that could also work against him because Rebeco, he throws the hooks and he goes to the body very well when you're in close. He's very good when you're in close. Mm-hmm. As to where I think if Nietes can keep this in the middle of the ring like he started doing the second half of the fight against Nantepec and work behind that jab, it could be easy for him. But
time out. Yeah, go ahead.
Go ahead. What was you about to say?
No, I wasn't going to say nothing. You said jab, and I was going to say that's the reason I'm picking him.
Go ahead. Right. So I'm going with Don Nietes, but I'm going to shock everybody, man. I think Nietes is going to knock this dude out. I think Nietes is looking to make a statement because, that's like you said, he wants to show everybody. They don't know who he is. Show up and show out. So I'm going to call for the knockout. I think he's going to show up and show out against a very top quality veteran.
This is what he gonna do, man. He gonna stop by 2K's house, get some of them power eggs, right? And get it popping, man. I'm telling you.
Damn, he's here, man. Rebecca's a hard guy to stop, though, man.
Yeah, he is.
He's the hardest fuck. I mean, Aoka, I think, is the only guy stopping.
I think he could keep it in the middle of the ring and show his skills. I think in the middle of the ring, he's a superior fighter. So that's where I could see. If as long as he does that, man, and stays behind that jab, he'll be all right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's a longer fighter and everything. Yeah. He's a longer fighter. He can literally win this fight with his jab.
Yes.
Well,
he can.
Yeah. He's 100% the better boxer. You know what I'm saying?
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
I'm going to go. It's going to be a clean sweep here. I got Donnie Nietzsche's too. But the difference here is that, you know, I'm not sure if he knocks him out. Kazuto Aoka, who's arguably the best 112-pound fighter, he knocked him out with a body shot. It was a beautiful right hook to the body and put Juan Carlos Ruffco out. Yeah. But Donnie Nietzsche, while he does go to the body, he doesn't commit on his shots to the body the way Kazuto Aoka does, or even like an Naoya Inoue. A lot of those Japanese fighters commit on their shots to the body. You know, Dago Higa's another guy that commits. But Donnie Nietzsche doesn't really commit, you know what I'm saying? So I don't think he will hurt Revco enough down there in order to replicate what Aoka did. But I do see him just out-slicking the fuck out of Revco. Revco does have a good jab, but he doesn't move very well in there. You know what I'm saying? He's kind of like Brian Valoria as far as the movement. You know what I'm saying? He can box, but he doesn't have the footwork for that style, the footwork that we would like to see for his particular style. You know what I'm saying? And I think that's going to be the downfall for Revco. He's going to be trying to get closer to Donnie Nietzsche, and he's going to be running into one-twos. And Donnie Nietzsche is excellent with being in defensive mode and coming out of his defensive mode with a lead left hand. You know what I'm saying? I mean, a lead right, excuse me. And also, he can lead with the uppercut, man. And then if he does get on the inside, I think he's a better inside fighter than Revco. So I think this will be a situation where it could be a Donnie Nietzsche's type of 116-112 type of fight, dog. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I don't stop. I can see that easy.
Yeah, I don't think he knocks him out, but he will beat the shit out of him 8 rounds, in my opinion. But this is the thing, though, before we move on. Donnie Nietzsche can be nullified in his attack by a great jab. That's one thing about him. So we'll see, man. I think this is going to be the most technical fight on the card. But the next one we're getting ready to go to, Carlos Quadras versus Mick Williams Arroyo. This will be the second most technical fight on the card. And this is actually a fight that I'm looking forward to simply because McWilliams Arroyo has kind of turned over a new leaf. At one point, I thought his brother McJoe, who's campaigning also at 115 pounds, I thought McJoe was better than him coming out of the amateurs. And actually, McJoe is the only one to hold a belt between the twins. I think he was the IBF title holder. He lost it to Jerwin and Cajas at 112 pounds. Ooh, that's a motherfucking beast at 115 right now. But McWilliams, he's tried for the title twice. He lost to Roman Gonzalez, of course. And then he lost to my motherfucking dude, Amnot Ruarong, who
badass at one time.
That's a bad motherfucker, man. He gave that overhyped ass Chinese motherfucker, Zhu Shiming, his first loss. And he also.
That's your boy.
He also, didn't he send him into retirement? He sent Zhu Shiming into retirement, didn't he?
Nah, it was another cat. Zhu Shiming lost again.
Else. He lost again after that.
Yeah.
Lost to Kimura.
Yeah, there you go.
But Amnot Ruarong also gave Kazuto Aoka his first loss. Y'all remember that shit.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely. So that's not his first, but his only.
Yeah.
Only loss. Yeah.
That's his only loss. Yeah. That's a bad motherfucker right there, man. So losing to those two guys, you know, it's not a knock on McWilliams whatsoever. You know what I'm saying? But Carlos Quadras, of course, at one point in time, he was the WBC title holder at 115 pounds. And I think he was lineal. You know what I'm saying? I want to say Ring Magazine gave him the ring belt at one point in time. I'm not looking it up. YouTube, if y'all listening, correct me if I'm wrong. But I believe he was lineal. And he's kind of fell by the wayside since that grueling, pretty competitive loss to Roman Gonzalez. And then he had another one against Juan Francisco Estrada. Let's go to my man C first, man, on this one. What do you think about this fight, man? Break down a prediction, fam.
I believe that this is a good fight. It's a lot better fight than what most people are going to look at it out the gate as. It's they're going to blow it off and go, Arroyo. But this fight's it's pretty spiffy, man. Actually, both of them, these guys can fight. Oh man, there was a gunshot there. That's the way we do out here in the country, man. Man, this guy probably shot a squirrel. You know what I mean? But I just believe that right now, that with Arroyo coming back, he's been off almost 2 years. Mm-hmm. All right. This will be 2 years since he fought. Okay. And Kudrass in that same time frame has fought fucking Gonzalez and Estrada. Buddy, it don't get much better than that at 115 fucking pounds.
Uh-huh.
You know, for that resume. I mean, he's done this in the last year, pretty much. When was it? Last March at the March the 4th, I think it was, when day of Jacobs and Golovkin. So March something. It was early March. And I was there whenever he beat Kudrass had fought was the fight before that for
David Carmona. So,
yeah, he was on that card. He's been on every card since then, since they fought each other with Gonzalez. And he's had Estrada, and the Carmona fight was
He looked bad.
I wasn't real impressed. I wasn't real impressed with him at all there. But I seen that it's almost like he fights to his competition.
Good point.
I did see, though, that he can be outsmarted. I just do not believe Arroyo is the guy to do it, especially after 2 years off.
No, he's not.
Especially after 2 years off, and that's what it's going to take. I think the physical advantages all go to Kudrass here, and that's what it's going to take for Arroyo to win this fight. It's to outsmart him, and I don't see it happening.
Nope. Really? You could have Mac Joe, Mac Williams, McDonald's.
McDonald's,
motherfucker, it don't fucking McShake. Matter. Who, it don't matter. What
don't
you
forget
bring
McDowell's.
Out here. McDowell's. That's right. Yeah, because we minority, so you know we got to fucking have the bootleg joint. So
hell yeah,
it word up, coming to America, Kim. So hey, it don't matter what it is, man. I got Kudrass winning this fight. I don't see him outsmarting him. I feel Kudrass is a better fighter. The better boxer. If I was Timothy, I would pick Mac Williams.
Of course you would.
But I'm not Timothy. So that's right. I'm the Puerto Rican picking the other guy. So
yeah, I mean, I just don't see any advantages.
I don't see it. I don't see how to me this is more of a showcase fight, man. That's how I view it.
I agree. Bo?
Yeah, I do too.
Man, listen.
What
are
we talking about? Go ahead.
I like Carlos. I like Carlos Kudrass. I think this fight is gonna shock a lot of people. Like Wooly said, man, I just don't see McWilliams Arroyo outsmarting, outboxing, and outclassing Kudrass. Kudrass has been in there with Roman Gonzalez in a fight that you can make a case that some people felt like, hey man, he actually won that fight. So
that was a good fight.
Yeah, the Estrada fight was a very close. I think if it wasn't for the knockdown, that fight could have went. Well, actually, he did win the fight, according to Michael Buffer, right? But you know, if it wasn't for that knockdown, he wins that fight. So, I think he's gonna have to watch out for Arroyo because he does have a mean left hook. So he's gonna have to watch out for that. But outside of that, man, I got Kudrass winning this fight. Kudrass is just a better boxer. He's also smarter. He's been in there with the top of level of competition. And like he said, he's coming off of a 2 year layoff too.
Like that's a lot of ring rust to shake off.
And you know what the bad thing about it is? I like Arroyo, but he wasn't necessarily like, I'm not trying to say that good, but he wasn't like, I've really felt like he had a lot to work on prior to him being gone.
Hey, him and his brother could probably fight with them first names.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Yeah.
Hey, I'll even add to y'all's concerns about him being out for 2 years. He's also moving up to 115, and he hasn't fought yet. He hasn't fought within the 115 weight limit since 2013. So you can go ahead and add
his last fight. Yeah,
5 years.
Yeah, his last fight was against Roman Gonzalez 2 years ago, almost now, and it was at 112. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean,
his last.
Even translate to 115. As you know, so
his last four fights have been at 112. So
yeah, there's a reason for that.
Yep. Right. I agree.
I like McJoe. I mean, McWilliams, man.
I know you do.
He's a good fighter, man. You know what I'm saying? The thing is with McWilliams, he's tough as nails. Actually, McWilliams to me is a younger Brian Valoria, in my opinion.
He's still getting his ass whooped.
Yeah, I think he might have a little more power. He sits down on his shots a little bit more, at least at 112 he did. But they're virtually the same, man. I mean, you got two guys who can box very well, have good counters. Both of them have good counter check hooks. You know what I'm saying? Both of them are good boxers, but they don't display the necessary footwork that you will want for that particular style. The thing is with McJoe, man, he'll wait until you get in range. And if you get in range, that's when he tries to counter you, but he has to reach you. You know what I'm saying? Also, his body work is excellent when he's in range. This is actually how he was able to get opportunities on Roman Gonzalez, because you got a high pressure, high volume type of fighter. Well, he stays in range. And that's how McWilliams is able to get off a lot of good shots against Roman Gonzalez. And he actually looked pretty decent in a fight where I think two judges had Roman winning every round, and then the third one had him winning 11 rounds, which I think was bullshit. I gave McWilliams 3 or 4 rounds, I believe. I can't remember.
I think people were actually saying that he had like a decent showing. Like,
he looked good.
Expect him to be, you know, but I still had Gonzalez winning that fight.
Oh, yeah.
Like, yeah, I had Gonzalez winning. I think McWilliams did better than what a lot of people thought he was going to do.
Fuck yeah.
I think that's why I had it 10 rounds of two, but there was 2 rounds that were close.
I had it
Warrior 9-3. I
can't argue between 8-4 to 10-2.
That's what I said. Yeah, because I said I had it 9-3 myself, actually.
I had it 9-3.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree. But coming in, like I said, I thought McJoe was better, and McWilliams did that showing that he had against Roman Gonzalez. He showed that he wasn't scared. At the time, Roman was running through cats. He was undefeated. Yep. You know, he showed that he wasn't scared, and he had the right game plan. And, you know, for that particular style, if you're in range, like I said, that's when he gets his opportunities. But the thing is with Carlos Quadras, he's an excellent fighter off his back foot. You know what I'm saying? Now, there's been two Carlos Quadras, as we've seen. We've seen the one that was prior to Roman Gonzalez and the one that was after Roman Gonzalez. So, really, this fight depends on which Carlos Quadras shows up. The one that fought David Carmona shows up, well, then McWilliams Arroyo is going to have a lot of opportunities to get off. If the one before Roman Gonzalez shows up, the one that I will say I agree with C when he said Quadras fights down to the level of his opponents. I agree with that post-Roman Gonzalez. Before, he didn't do that. He was killing cats at 115. But if he fights that particular way, then this should be almost a damn near shutout, because the Carlos Quadras that boxes off his back foot, that is a hard motherfucker to beat. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, the guy that used to like use his opponent's offense against them and, you know, capitalize over that. But, you know what, guys, I got an announcement too. Mac Williams is bringing his Cuban cousin, Mac Bo.
Oh, shit. Oh, then I changed my pick. You didn't tell me he was bringing a Cuban cousin, a Puerto Rican with a Cuban cousin.
No, you motherfucker, Mac Bo.
I gotta be like Timothy.
Bo ain't never been a Mac, period. But anyway.
Anyway, let me finish my shit.
To the show.
Anyway, but because we got one more fight to cover. I want to get it in before Bo has to leave. But like I said, it depends on which Carlos Quadras shows up. I think Carlos is smart enough to do to have the easier way out in this particular fight. He will do the game plan that he should do, and that is, you know, stay on the outside, utilize his jab, and he did it a lot against Francisco Estrada. Juan Francisco Estrada, but Estrada's just outsmarted him, and we'll get to that in a minute. But I think he will continue what he did in that fight here. I think he beats McWilliams Arroyo rather handedly. I say he wins maybe 4, 8 or 9 rounds against McWilliams Arroyo. All right, let's move on to the main event. This will be Sarissa Kitsoa Rungvisai. Boy, I done got that name down, nigga. Yo, I was actually practicing that bitch.
You know what I'm saying?
I was practicing that shit back in the day, man, when he fought Roman Gonzalez the first time. I was in there practicing that shit before I did a show. But
we still ended up calling him whatchamacallit.
You called him
whatchamacallit. Wingate?
Yeah. His name is, oof.
We can feel Wingate. That's for people to read Box Rec all the time.
Yeah.
That's Box. Box. See, they don't even have that name like on the broadcast. Box Rec need to switch it up, man.
Yeah, that's what I said. That's the people that read Box Rec all the time.
But yeah, Rungvisai, of course, man. He is the WBC World Super Flyweight Champion. The belt that he won off of Roman Gonzalez, giving him his first and second loss. Second loss was by brutal fourth round knockout. Beautiful fucking. Wasn't it a counter left hook? If I'm not mistaken.
Counter right hook. Wide ass hooks. I was talking about.
Put on the inside, which is the key.
Yeah, that to work. The fact is he landed a counter punch. That's the shit that you know what I'm saying. That's the shit that got me.
He's a better counter puncher than people believe he is.
Hey, 2K, you got your eggs. He got his rats. So
he's a little better counter puncher than what he initially thought.
Yeah, man. He, you know what? This guy burst on the scene. And you know the first fight, it's like okay. The second fight, he made you a fucking believer and shit, and then you start rooting for the motherfucker because you're like, okay, I can get behind a guy like this, like him. I think in this fight, the key will be Strada has to fight 12 rounds. He's got to start off early. He's got to have if he could keep it even going into the second half of the fight. He could have a shot because Rungvisai is gonna come, man, and he's gonna keep coming and coming and coming. I mean, Roman Gonzalez hit him with bombs, torpedoes, man, everything, missiles, and he just kept coming. So, like, you know, I think Estrada is a good boxer, but like C-Bone said yesterday, man, he has tendencies, man. He loves that 1-2 and the hook to the body. And he's got to find a way to switch it up a little bit because if he becomes too predictable, man, that boy's going to get on the inside, hit him with a counter, and watch out.
But the main thing Estrada got to do is keep it in a boxing match.
Yes.
He cannot turn it into what Roman Gonzalez turned it into. See, the thing about Rungvisai is, which is intriguing to me, is we don't know if this is a situation where he just ran into the right opponent in Roman Gonzalez come forward and stay right in front of the center line.
But when you do it twice,
and that's what I'm finna get to. Then he beats him, and then he grows into that championship. So now what Estrada is dealing with is a dude that is super fucking high on confidence, and super fucking convinced that yo, I'm the shit now. You got to come get this from me, and he's strong willed, and so is Estrada, which makes this fight even better to me, in my opinion, because you got two strong-willed dudes. You got two dudes that ain't going back down. And I think Rungvisai has shown us, unlike most cats who jump on the scene and win belts, he's a lot more skilled than we thought. He's a very good counterpuncher. He actually, for a guy who punches in close, he throws the quickest wide right hookers I've ever seen in my life. But he doesn't smother himself either. For a guy like he doesn't smother himself. So he's smart on how he works. So it's good, man. It's good.
Do you understand that white hook wouldn't work on the outside?
No.
You gotta have the perfect distance. Go ahead,
I'm about to dead y'all's predictions, man. Go ahead, C.
And it's dead The wide hooks that you're talking about, the reason they weren't bet on the inside is because lack of your peripheral vision works right. better the farther away it gets. Okay.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And that's the reason they work better on the inside. When you're close, you don't pick it up. As far as I say peripheral vision, I'm not just talking about straight out with a 90-degree angle point. I'm talking about all the way around. All right, you pick that punch up as it's coming wide from the outside, you'll pick it up at about 9 o'clock, say. You know what I mean? Say you're sitting at 6 o'clock, you'll pick that punch up at between 9:30 and 10 o'clock, you'll see it coming. Mm-hmm. All right. That gives you a better reaction time. Whenever he's in close, you don't see that punch. It's some bitch is almost like 7 o'clock on your ass.
Yeah.
So I mean it's almost been closed the clock on you. So the reaction time is gone. That's the reason wide shots work a lot better in tight. You know, when you got your heads together, and you're coming forward, and that's the type of fighter he is. Now for Estrada to beat him, he's gonna have to cause him to reset quite a bit. All right. Mm-hmm. And I don't mean like he doesn't have to do it like you could either do it with a jab, and do it with a jab to the body's fucking great for it. All right. But you can also do it through movement. I talked a little bit about it yesterday. You can do it through movement, through feints. There's all kinds of things you can do about it. For a feint to work a little better, you need to have made him respect you. And I don't think Running Beside respects anybody. All right. I really don't, because if he did, Gonzalez don't have the trouble he has with him in the first fight, because he beat the dog shit out of him, man. He landed over 600 shots on this guy. Landed over 600 fucking punches on this guy, and he kept coming forward.
That high pressure style with no defense.
Kept coming forward. Let me come again. Yeah, I'm gonna come again. That's all you can hit me with. I'm coming. I'm like, what the fuck, man? This is a zombie.
But Estrada hits a little bit harder than Estrada hits a little bit harder than Gonzalez, and he's
got to start early though.
He's got to start early, because you're gonna. I don't give a fuck who you are at this size right here. You're gonna have to wear Running Beside down without landing a perfect body shot. All right. Now, Estrada throws a good left hook to the body, but he never seems to come out with it off the jump. He's always got it behind a 1-2. He loves to throw a 1-2-3. It's like he's just learned it in English or something, and he's excited about it. You know what I mean? Watch him. He loves it. He truly loves it. But the key is going to be him being able to get in and get out when he does that. Now, okay, but if you watch Estrada, the longer he fights, the more comfortable he comes with seeing what you're going to do. You know what I mean? If you have any type of pattern to you, he's going to beat your brains in by the 7th, 8th, 9th, 10th round. That's just the type of fighter he is. That's how he was able to flip that fight against Cordes. That right there was precision, man. That was that was a surgeon in the ring going, yeah, cut that vein, slice this thing.
Very smart.
You know, it was super intelligent. I was like, how in the hell did he not beat Gonzalez? I was thinking.
That's what I was saying.
When I watched that Gorgeous fight, I'm like, how in the hell did he not beat Gonzalez? Because I've been telling people for a couple of years that he beats Gonzalez in the rematch. He beats Gonzalez in the rematch.
I believe
so, too. And people kind of blew me off. I said, whoever gets to Gonzalez first, him in no way, is going to beat him.
It's going to beat him.
People kind of blew me off. Yeah. I said, nah, seriously. Estrada, if we was doing a skill-based pound-for-pound top 10, he's going to make my top 5 or 6 every time down there.
Okay.
You know, he's up there. You know, there's a lot of people got him in the top 10 pound for pound now. He's extremely underrated, extremely versatile fighter. But that starting slow, I think, gets him in trouble here.
Okay.
And if he can come out of round 5 with 2 rounds in the bank, Estrada, then he's got a very good chance in this fight. Very good chance. But if he comes out of it 4-1 or 5-0 down, he's fucked. I believe he's done. And he's goosed. If he throws, not lands, but throws 600 to 700 punches in this fight, he can win. He's going to have to be a little more active than what he has been recently, because Running Beside is going to bring his 700, 800, 900.
Yeah.
He's coming with him. You know what I mean? He's coming with him. All right. Yeah. He's going to bring his. You better bring yours with you. So he's got his guns at the party, you know, and that's just how he is. And people look at his record, his resume ain't the fucking best in the world. But if you look at he lost to Cordes, all right, Running Beside did. That fight, was a close fight on the judges. I mean, it wasn't real close, but it was closer than, especially considering where the fight was at. You know what I mean? When you look at the scorecard, you're going, you know, 4-3, 5-2. That really ain't that close a fight. Well, they're fighting in fucking Georgia's house, backyard. You know what I mean? Mexico is not exactly the best place, the most reliable place in the world for judging.
Well, you're going directly into mine.
And, yeah. Okay. This guy is a hell of a lot better than what you think he is, man. I mean, he's a hell of a lot better than what you think he is. And I do believe that Rungbasai wins a decision here. He's got enough output to win this decision.
Damn. Okay.
Well, I'm just going to sit back and hold on, guys.
It's going to be a very close fight because Estrada is capable of closing the show. And
let me get this popcorn bag.
Yeah, because I'm about to murder this shit, bro. Listen. You know, C is my dude. Motherfucker broke it down intelligently as hell. And I might be wrong. You know what I'm saying? There's been times where C was right, I was wrong. Willie was wrong, he was right. Bo was wrong, and he was right, right? But this is the thing on paper, what I'm looking at here. Roman Gonzalez was tailor-made for a guy like Sarisikit Sor Rungvisai. Now, Rungvisai is my motherfucking dude. I told y'all after he knocked out Roman Gonzalez that he was going to be on a pound-for-pound list. A lot of niggas laughed at me. 2K, you don't know shit about boxing. What happened? Ring Magazine put him in there, and the BWAA, Boxing Writers Association, put him in there. You know what I'm saying? So I knew that shit was going to happen, right? But this is the thing. Roman Gonzalez was a one-dimensional fighter, but he was good at his dimension, right? He was an excellent high-pressure, high-volume fighter. He was excellent at breaking people down at 112 and at 108, right? At 115, when he moved up, Carlos Quadras, in my opinion, beat that ass. It was a close fight, but I had Quadras winning that fight, right? And you saw how the power at 115 was too much for a guy Roman Gonzalez's size. So when he stepped in the ring with Sarisikit Sor Rungvisai, on paper, it was like, yeah, Rungvisai is one-dimensional. He has slow footwork. He doesn't really have good hand speed, contrary to what Bo thinks that right hook came at. I disagree with Bo on that one. That right hook was slow as fuck, but it was because what C said, Roman Gonzalez is on the inside. He couldn't see it coming. He actually pulled back a little bit and put himself directly in the trajectory for that fucking
because he called it. He called it late. He called it out his eye late. Yep.
Exactly. So it was a slow hook, but it was just perfectly thrown. Combinations are slow. You know what I'm saying? Doesn't have any good defense. Runs into punches. I think he's a good fighter when he's fighting smaller guys that are pressure fighters just like him, because this is the same shit that I said about Jermall Charlo when he fought J-Rock Williams. I said, this is going to be a fight between two guys who are going to determine who's the alpha male in the ring. And I believed before that fight that Jermall Charlo was the alpha male over Julian Williams. This was the same shit with Roman Gonzalez. You had two alpha males in the ring who depend on breaking their opponents down. Well, who's going to be the alpha male? Who's going to get broken down first? And the person that ended up getting broken down first was Roman Gonzalez, simply because he was too small. Now, if I'm Juan Francisco Estrada, all I need to do is, during training camp, is go get a DVD player, right? Call up Carlos Quadras, his coach, you know, speak to him in Spanish about getting that goddamn CD between him and Sarisikit Sor Rungvisai, that fight that happened in what, 2014, 2015? 2014, right? Let me get that DVD, dog. Pop that shit in and watch how Carlos Quadras, even though that fight was close, one judge had it pretty wide, but the other two judges at the time of the technical decision had it like 2 points for Quadras. Quadras was outboxing him. There were times where Sarisikit Sor Rungvisai was able to get inside and have his opportunities, and that's just because Carlos Quadras had to stop moving at times. I mean, use all the goddamn ring, you're gonna get tired eventually. You know what I'm saying? So he would stop, you know, recuperate. When he was in recuperation mode, that's when Rungvisai would actually get inside of him, start landing shots. But at the end of the day, the game plan is to just outbox this motherfucker. Don't do what Roman Gonzalez did, or else you're gonna get knocked out, or you're gonna get hurt very badly. Also, in my opinion, Estrada, as we already seen, is a smarter fighter than Carlos Quadras. He can do everything Carlos Quadras can do, but he's smarter. Only thing is, I don't think he has the type of footwork, the type of movement Quadras has, but he has enough movement to elude Rungvisai. If Rungvisai's slow-ass footwork, you know what I'm saying, is trying to apply pressure with his slow-ass combinations, he's definitely smart enough to elude that shit. You know what I'm saying? Also, in my opinion, people might disagree, Quadras kind of flings with his jab, okay? Estrada uses his jab as if it's a straight right hand. You see what I'm saying? He has an excellent jab, and he can actually lead with his jab to start off his combinations beautifully. It stagnates his opponents, and it allows him to get the rest of his shots off. You know what I'm saying? I think this is a sweep, in my opinion. I think it's just the fact that while I like Rungvisai, don't get me wrong, it's just the fact that Roman Gonzalez, given his style and how much smaller he was perfect for Rungvisai. And we've already seen a guy outbox Rungvisai. The blueprint is already there, right? It's just that Rungvisai has not fought a boxer on that level since. And that's going to be the issue here. He's getting in the ring and fighting a boxer on the same level as Carlos Quadras. His last time he lost to a boxer, he will be getting in the ring with that type of fighter this Saturday. So that's going to be the difference here. And in my opinion, Rungvisai is the same fighter he was when he fought Quadras, then when he fought Roman Gonzalez twice, and when he steps in the ring on Saturday. What he does in the ring against those guys is all he knows. There is no teaching him anything else because it's that brawler type of style. There is no teaching him anything else. So I think it's a sweep, man. I think I think Rungvisai wins a few rounds. Like what C said early on, he's going to start off. Estrada's going to start off trying to read Rungvisai, seeing where, you know, what he likes to do. And C made a good point that I think goes against his prediction. He said that Estrada is excellent at catching patterns. Well, when you have a one-dimensional fighter in front of you, all he's going to be doing is setting patterns. You see what I'm saying? So I think Estrada is going to set or find that pattern. It's going to be a clean sweep. I say after round three, it's going to be a clean sweep. We'll see, though. Y'all got anything y'all want to add?
No. No, because, I mean, the fight could easily go that way. But he's got, I mean, if like I said, it's a guarantee if Estrada throws enough punches. If he throws 600-plus punches, it's almost a guarantee, in my opinion, for him to win. I just don't think he's going to have the output.
Yeah.
I don't think he's going to have the output. And if he digs too deep a hole, I don't believe the output will catch him, be enough to catch him up.
I agree.
And I think that's what the judges will be looking at. I know the judges, you got Jack Rice, Kathy Leonard, and Moretti scoring the fight. Rice is a referee. I mean, Moretti and Moro scoring that fight. So
okay.
Moretti loves the activity. He always favors activity. Yeah. Leonard, she somewhat does. Moro's a little more unknown than like a Moretti or somebody.
I think also with this fight being in America, man, and more so closer to Rungvisai because he's from Sonora, Mexico, which is a part of the California area of Mexico. And the fight is in Inglewood. I think Rungvisai will have to have the type of showing he had against Roman Gonzalez. And Estrada is not going to give him those opportunities, man. He's too smart of a fighter. You know what I'm saying? He either had to knock Estrada out, and Estrada has never been knocked out, or he's going to have to literally beat him up for 12 rounds. I don't see that happening, man, given Estrada's IQ. I really don't. So when this fight was announced, I was like, fuck, man, my boy about to lose. Like, real talk. But we'll see, though, man. It's going to be an excellent fight, excellent night of boxing.
Superfly.
Yeah, man. If y'all don't know what time it is, man, make sure you tune in. It's gonna be 9:30 Eastern time. That's 8:30 Central time. That's 6:30 Pacific. And then for you motherfucking British cats, that's 2:30 a.m. You know what I'm saying? Make sure you catch it on HBO Boxing After Dark.
They're not getting it.
they can hit the stream. That's what 2K does. Hit the stream. So, nah, but we don't do on this channel what we do on the other channels. Hey, guys, where can they find you? Fuck out of here with that. This is the movement. know what I'm saying? My man, Willie the Kid, find him on Eastway Boxing. Of course, my man Bo had to go. He's the creator and host of Truth and Facts About Boxing. You can catch all three of us, of course, on 3kingsboxing.com. Myself, Willie the Kid, and C-Bone, who's on here right now. We are the founders of that website. We're also writing articles on there, giving y'all the latest and greatest. Make sure y'all visit that shit. You can find my man C-Bone on Four Corners Boxing Talk on Blog Talk Radio. And, of course, Willie the Kid is the host of that as well, the secondary host of that as well. So, and of course, I mean, you already here, so you know where I'm at. So it is what it is. Make sure you keep supporting the movement if you are supporting it. We two months old, going on 3 months, right? So
yeah, we're almost 3 months. Yeah.
Almost 3 months, man. And we got a pretty good, pretty solid fan base over on 3kingsboxing.com. And we got a solid fan base of people following the movement, man. I'm getting inquiries and shit. Motherfuckers trying to join. You know what I'm saying? So it's good, man. I appreciate everybody who is supporting us. From the casual fan to the boxing enthusiast, man. I appreciate all of y'all. Also appreciate everybody in the chat. If you just got here, shit, show about to end. But we will do this again, fellas. We will do this again. All right? This is Real Talk for Real Fans. One.